Hi friends, welcome back. Today we are discussing on the chapter, rheology chapter, coming under the subject physical pharmaceutics 2, that is coming in 4th semester BPharm. So here we are going to discuss the important portions coming under the chapter rheology. As you all know, the rheology means the science that concern with the flow of liquids and deformation of solid. So we can start the discussion on the important portion from rheology. First of all, we are just going through the example coming under different type of fluid, because it is very important in case of some competitive exam. So we know based on the flow or the property shown by the liquid, they are classifying the liquid into Newtonian and non-Newtonian. So the examples of Newtonian liquids include water, clear fruit juices, milk, honey, vegetable oil, corn syrup. Whereas the non-Newtonian system include the plastic flow, pseudoplastic behavior and dilated flow. So under the plastic flow, we can find out a number of examples under the plastic flow also, like concentrated suspensions, butter, ointment, paste, gel, etc. And second category under non-Newtonian is pseudoplastic. Examples are applesauce, banana purees, orange juice concentrate, French mustard, dairy cream, etc. And the dilatants, the third category, examples are some types of honey, the 40% raw cornstarch solution, etc. So we can discuss in detail in coming slides. And next one, the Bincan plastic. For that, we can tell the example as tomato paste, toothpaste, etc. Then, when you go across some competitive exam, you may find this term, Herschel-Buckley fluid. What do you mean by that? So, it is a generalized model concept proposed by the two scientists Herschel and Buckley, and it will give a model on non-Newtonian fluid. In this, we are experiencing a strain related to a stress in a non-complexated or non-linear manner. So when you think about the Herschel-Buckley fluid, it is relating to the non-Newtonian fluid. So please think that. We are just going through the various plots that we get when we plot the rate of shear on y-axis and shearing stress on the x-axis. So if it is a Newtonian flow, it will give, or if it obeys the Newton's law, it will show a straight line starting from the origin zero. But in case of non-Newtonian, that is the fluid that does not obey this Newtonian flow, then such fluids are known as non-Newtonian fluids. It includes this plastic, pseudoplastic as well as dilatant flow. Okay, so this plots we are calling as rheograms. And in case of Newtonian flow, we know the properties. What are the properties in case of Newtonian flow? What type of fluids? We already discussed the fluid nature. Then in case of simple plastic flow, that is coming under non-Newtonian flow, we can find out a curve that does not pass from the origin, but initially this stage it behaves like an elastic body. And after applying stress, it will become a straight line. So when we find out the slope, we get a point, that is we get a slope, and mobility is the slope that we are getting from this graph. And when we extrapolate the same to the x-axis, we get a value that is denoted by small f, and it is known as yield value. In third case, that is in the case of pseudoplastic flow, when we plot rate of shear against shearing stress, we are finding a curve starting from the origin. But when we increase the shear stress progressively, shear rate also increases. But you just go through this diagram. Here we are finding the trend is not a linear curve. Okay. So in case of a third flow under new Newtonian, that is the dilatant flow. So in case of dilatant flow, we are seeing an opposite action. That is, the system exhibits an enhanced resistance to flow with increasing rate of shear. Such system is known as dilatant flow. So I think we can move to the important questions coming from. And in this chapter itself, we come across some fluids, thixotropic fluids like that. That is, you just know what is the difference between thixotropic fluids and rheopectic fluid. Thixotropic fluids means it exhibits a decrease in shear stress over a constant shear rate. But in case of rheopectic, it exhibits an increase in shear stress at constant shear rate. So the examples for the thixotropic fluids include the mayonnaise, egg food, white, baby foods, yogurt, etc. And in case of rheopectic fluid, examples are whipping cream, lubricant, etc. So next we are just thinking about how the temperature will affect the viscosity. So it is proposed by the scientist Arrhenius, and equation is equal to mu is equal to BAEA by RT, where BA is Arrhenius constant, EA is the activation energy, R universal Gans constant, and T is the temperature. So next we are moving to the law XA. First question, define and explain non-Newtonian flow of liquid. We already discussed under the non-Newtonian flow of liquid, three are the right. That is, the first one, it includes the plastic, pseudoplastic, and dilated. So we have to draw the diagram first, then you have to write about the individual characteristic of each fluid, and under each you have to write some examples also. So for the plastic flow, you can write the example we already discussed. So in that first case, that is the plastic flow, you have to write about the yield value, that means the stress required to break the interparticle contraction. So you have to mention about the yield value. You have to draw the diagram wherever possible. So after that, you have to write about the Bingham bodies. That means the materials that exhibit this plastic flow are oftenly called as Bingham bodies. Then after that, you have to write about the plastic viscosity, U is equal to F minus F by G. Under the pseudoplastic flow also, we have to write what type of behavior we are seeing in case of rheogram or pseudoplastic flow. We have to write the example. Then when the polymers at first, what is the condition after applying stress, what happened? The polymers will align on long axis and water is get released. So we are finding out a deviation in the equation, that is F raised to N is equal to eta dash G. And you have to explain each equation. After that, the third one under non-Newtonian dilatant flow. So here we are finding out an increase in viscosity. So the dilatant flow, otherwise known as shear thickening system. Likewise, pseudoplastic is known as shear thinning system. So in the dilatant flow, we know the best examples are suspensions containing high concentration of the solid, suspension of starch in water, etc. So we have to, likewise, under three subheading, we have to elaborate the first long essay. After that, define the Newtonian flow of liquid, explain the shear thinning system of fluid. So you don't get confused. First part, define the non-Newtonian flow of liquid. So first of all, you have to write about the Newtonian flow. That is, if the liquids that obey the Newton laws flow is called Newtonian fluids, then you have to write about F is equal to eta G. Then you have to draw the rheogram. You have to write the example under that. After that, you have to write about the second part is explain the shear thinning system of liquid. So this shear thinning system, we know it will come under which one? Pseudoplastic flow. Shear thinning system, we are telling it is pseudoplastic flow. It will come under the non-Newtonian flow. So as we already discussed, we have to write the points under pseudoplastic flow. Then third question, we have to write about what is define thixotropy. And explain different method for its determination and give its application in pharmacy. So in case of thixotropy, we have to write about what is thixotropy. That means It is a isothermal and comparatively slow recovery happening in the body on standing of a material. And it is mostly seen in case of shear thinning system. That is, when we are agitating the shear thinning system, it expects to return to the original state of the fluid. And this behavior we are calling as thixotropic behavior. So that is what is thixotropy. After that, they ask the question, explain the different method for its determination and use application. So we can determine this thixotropy by three types. The first one, we are plotting out the up and down curves of the rheogram, and using the help of a planimeter, we are finding out the thixotropy. Second case is that we are drawing the nature of rheogram, and we are drawing a plot using a rate of shear versus shearing stress, and after that we are coming to the derivation, that is the thixotropic coefficient is equal to B is equal to U1 minus U2 divided by ln T2 by T1. And the third method is that we are applying the subject or system to different rate of shear. Then we are obtaining a coefficient, that is the thixotropic coefficient, that is M is calculated using the equation capital M is equal to 2 into U1 minus U2 ln divided by ln V2 by V1. That are the different methods for determination of thixotropy. And the third part is that give the application of thixotropy in pharmacy. We know this thixotropy is a desirable property, particularly in emulsion, suspension, etc. So, first point is that if the thixotropy is better, what happens? The physical stability is also higher in case of suspension. So, during storage, we want to know the consistency, then only we can maintain the stability of the product. So, first point is that higher the physical stability in case of greater thixotropy. Second thing is that the degree of thixotropy is related to the specific surface, especially in case of penicillin. So, we have to write this two under the applications of thixotropy in pharmacy. Then the third question, same application is asking the fourth question also, you can add the application. And the first part is that define the mechanism of thixotropy. So while writing the thixotropy, have to draw some diagram. That is, when you plot the rate of shear versus shearing stress, you can find out how the pseudoplastic system or plastic flow appears. That is, we know at rest, or if you are keeping the liquids at rest, what happens? Multipoint contacts will occur because of the high consistency or high viscosity. So at rest, it will behave as a gel state. But when you apply on shear or an equilibrium state, what happens? This contact get breakdown. So what happens? The consistency or the viscosity get less. Then the gel state coming to a solid state. This is not an instantaneous process. And after we are keeping for set aside for a time, or if you are removing the stress, what happens? The particle contacts are re-established due to the Brownian motion. Again, what happens? The high consistency or high viscosity get achieved. Then it again return to the gel state. So you have to write this gel solid gel transformation when you ask about the mechanism of thixotropy. Define the viscosity, classify different viscometer with example. That is, you have to ask about the single point viscometer. Next question, same thing. Define viscosity, classify different viscometer with example. Here you have asked to write about one multi-point viscometer. And third one, they are asking with the help of a neat diagram, you have to write about the principle of cup and bob with its disadvantages and the principle of the Kalman plate with its advantages. So we can explain this three question. This is a repeatedly asked question, so you can discuss one by one. So first of all, you are asked to write about, define the viscosity. So what do you mean by viscosity? In case of viscosity, in the initial part of rheology, this viscosity is very important, because viscosity means what? We are telling viscosity is the index of resistance of a liquid to flow. So if higher the viscosity, what happens? Greater the resistance to flow is the. So we are determining the eta is equal to F by G. That is, viscosity is calculated by theta is equal to f by g. So based on the rate of shear what we are applying, we are classifying the viscometer into two categories. That is, the viscometer are classified into either into single point viscometer or multi point viscometer. So under single point viscometer, we are applying a single rate of shear. Example, in case of Ostwald viscometer, and this case, this is the Ostwald viscometer, and the second case, Pauling sphere viscometer. This are the example for single point viscometer. Okay, so first of all, we can discuss. So they are asked, first of all, we have to define viscosity. After that, they have to write about any of the viscometer. Okay, Ostwald viscometer is otherwise known as capillary viscometer, and here using this we can determine the dynamic as well as kinematic viscosity. So what is the principle? So first of all, whatever it is, we have to draw the diagram. This is the diagram of Ostwald viscometer. That is, we know the liquid will flow by gravity. So here we are noting, you just look to the diagram, that is A and B, two points are there, right? So we are determining the time of flow required by the liquid to move from A to B. So we are using a standard, normally water, and using that we are determining the viscosity of the unknown liquid or sample. Okay, so you have to write this principle so that you know what is the procedure, right? That is, first of all, we have to clean the viscometer, and with the help of a paper we are adding a fixed amount of water, and we are allowing the liquid or water to flow from A to B, and we are noting how much time it required to take from A to B, and we are putting this T1 and T2 values in this equation. This is the equation to determine the viscosity. Eta 1 is equal to rho 1 T1 by rho 2 T2 into E2, where eta 1 is the, this eta 1 is the viscosity of the sample or unknown liquid, where rho 1 is the density, 1 related to the unknown liquid. So density of the unknown liquid, time required by the unknown liquid, the denominator rho 2 and T2 means the density of the standard and time required by the standard, eta 2 is the viscosity of the standard. That is about the single point viscometer. Second one is the work under the single point viscometer is the Pauling sphere viscometer. So it is otherwise known as Hoppler viscometer also. So this apparatus consists of a glass tube. This is the glass tube. It is positioned vertically, and we are applying a constant temperature jacket around this glass tube to provide the water circulation uniformly. And here in this glass tube, we are applying a test liquid is placed in the glass chamber. After that, we are dropping a glass or steel drop or steel ball into the liquid, and we are allowing to reach equilibrium temperature. Okay, so we are noting here how much time taken for the ball to fall from this A to B. Okay, so here we are determining by using the equation is eta is equal to T into SB minus SF into B, where eta is the viscosity, T is the time interval in seconds for the ball to fall between A and B. SB means SB, B and F are subscript, and SB means the specific gravity of the ball, and SF means the specific gravity under the fluid under examination, and B is a constant for a particular ball supplied by the manufacturer. Next one, under multi-point viscometer, here we are applying several rate of shear. So in case of first one, the cup and bowl viscometer, have to write about, this is a example of multi-point viscometer, and it also come under the category of rotational viscometer. So we are placing a sample, we are placing a sample inside this. So this is the outer part, that is a stationary cup, and this is a rotating bob. So sample is accommodating between this cup and bob, and we can rotate either the cup or the bob in this method. So revolving cup type is cuvette, that is cuvette type, and revolving bob type is Serly type. So here we are determining the viscosity also. This is the method in cup and bob viscometer. Next one is the corn and plate viscometer. In this, the thing is that we are placing, this also have two parts. This is a stationary place, and above that we are applying a rotating corn. Okay, so in between we are placing the sample. So in the center of the plate we are applying the sample, and the corn is driven by a variable speed motor. What happened? The sample gets here in between the gap between the stationary plate and rotating corn. So after that, when we get the values, we are plotting RPM, that is the weight of shear versus the scale reading, how much shear stress, and we can find out the viscosity from this corn and plate viscometer. So that is all about the multi-point and single-point viscometer. Next, we can move to the short essays. So we already discussed about the Newtonian system of flow with example. We already discussed about plastic and dielectric flow of liquid. Discuss the plastic and pseudoplastic system of flow. Again, they ask about the shear thickening system. So in shear thickening system, we have to write about the dielectric system with example. Then they ask about the mechanism of thixotropy with example. So we have to write about the salt gel salt formation. We have to draw the diagram or rheogram also to get. After that, you have asked to write, explain the method to determine thixotropy. We already discussed about three methods you have to write here. Then they asked about the principle of cup and we have to draw the diagram. After that, you have to write the principle how we can determine the viscosity. Then the next question, explain the principle of the Ostwald viscometer or capillary viscometer. You have to write the principle, you have to draw the diagram how we can find the. Then short essays means 2-mark question. In the first one, you have to write, define rheology. We already discussed, give any two application. The rheology have number of application. Among that, you can write this rheology can concept can be used in the manufactured dosage form as well as the handling of drugs for the administration. Then next question, describe the rheogram. We know what it is, that is the rate of shear versus shear ratio, what we are plotting. Then four cases you can draw the rheogram. And next one is about rheopexy. Rheopexy means salt form a gel more readily when shaken or shear than when allowed to form gel. That is actually rheopexy. Here gel is in the equilibrium state. Then next question they are asking is what is yield value. So in the rheogram we come across the plastic, pseudoplastic and dilatant, right? So in the plastic flow system you can find out, that is in the initial it is not starting from the origin, like this curve we are obtaining in case of plastic. After that we are getting a straight line. So that straight line, when we extrapolate to x-axis, we get some value small of, that is known as yield value. So you can write what is yield value here. And next one, define dilatancy. So again asking about the dilatant with the example. Then next one, the define Newton's law of fluid, that is F is equal to E to the G. You can. Next question, give example for the plastic and pseudoplastic. We already discussed what is negative thixotropy. So in case of negative thixotropy, you have to write about anti-thixotropy. Negative thixotropy, otherwise known as anti-thixotropy. It represents and you can find out an increase in consistency on the downward curve. This is better explained by the magnesium magma. That is, in magnesium magma, what happened? We can find out an enhanced resistance to flow with increased time of shear. So we can explain with the help of magnesium magma to explain this negative thixotropy. Then they ask about what are bulges, pearls, etc. So you can write what are bulges. That is, in case of bulges, we can tell with the help of the example concentrated aqueous magma gel or bentonite. That is, in here we are founding what a complex type of rheogram. But in case of spurs, we are explaining with the help of procaine tension gel. That in this we can find out a spur-like protrusion in this. And the spur value represents a sharp point or the structural breakdown of the polymer or the drug. Then you have to write again the same question as explain the bulges with examples, spurs with examples, explain with the help of example. Then last one, what is the plug flow? How do you overcome it? We know this plug flow is one of the disadvantages of cup band bob viscometer. So when we apply the sample in the gap between cup band bob, this type of plug flow can be occur. So to avoid that, that is when the bob is rotated lower rear shear, what happened? The stressor closer to the rotating bore may be higher than the yield value. So what happened? The material at the inner wall of the cup remained as a solid plug or not able to flow. That is not a solid plug formation, is not a plug flow. So we can overcome it by two methods. We can use largest bore possible in order to reduce the gap, or we can increase the speed of rotation. Next one, we already tell what is anti-thixotropy, explain the mechanism. Next one, explain the term shear thinning. Shear thinning means pseudoplastic and shear thickening dilated. And you have to write a example. Hope this session will be helpful for you. If you are not subscribed till now, please subscribe. And if you find this video useful, please share to your friends also. Thank you.